formerly all-volunteer community theater in the Mid-Ohio Valley. Please note the emergency exit doors on either side of the stage. Of course, there is no smoking or flash photography permitted. We also ask that you please silence your cell phones. We invite you to experience the magic of live theater. Enjoy. And now, our show.
Well, I was just telling you that I murdered exactly 52 people since I last saw you.
Oh, yes, one a week. How did you do it?
Every way I could think of. I electrocuted some in their baths, locked some in the garage with the motor running, or pushed them through windows or over cliffs. Other weeks I preferred to poison, shoot, strangle, stab them, slug them, even suffocate them.
Just according to how you felt.
When you write for that kind of television, you don't have time to feel anything.
Where do you get your ideas from?
Oh, newspaper stories, police files, bad dreams, other writers.
Oh, you once told me you'd never write anything that wasn't original.
Well, you try being original 52 times a year.
Suppose you just dry up and can't think of anything.
If it comes to that, I just use my three hats.
What do you mean?
Well, I have three old hats marked. Who kills who, how, and why.
Which is what? I mean, what's why?
Well, why is the motive for killing? You've got to have a motive, you know. There are only five important ones. Fear, jealousy, money, revenge, and protecting someone you love. I just write them down on pieces of paper and then pick one out of the why hat.
Sounds rather like sorting the week's washing.
It's about as artistic as that, but better paid. It's no more frustrating than writing plays that aren't produced, or novels that aren't published. Oh, and don't forget this. It all goes to prove that Whiteo makes teeth bright. White and white.
Let's have your glass, Max.
No, I'm all right, thanks.
I could hardly believe it when I heard your voice. At first I thought you were phoning from New York.
Yes, I thought you were shouting a little louder than necessary. As a matter of fact, I was just around the corner. Was it all right with my phone like that?
Oh, yes, of course.
Was that Tony who answered?
Yes, it was. Poor darling, I hope he isn't going to be too late. He always gets caught when we're going to the theater. So, you're not here on a holiday this time?
No, not this time. I just came over to write some short TV films. After that, I think I'll knock off for a year and write that novel. I've got to write it someday.
Another crime story?
Well, I have to stick to crime. It's my stock in trade. But there's no reason why a murder story can't be as good as anything else. And I think I could write a good one if I take my time. I thought of a fair gimmick on the plane coming over. There's a pair of identical twins. One lives in Paris and the other in New York. All of a sudden, they both decide to...
Max! Before Tony comes, I ought to explain something.
Yes?
You see, I haven't told him anything about us.
Oh.
When you rang, I just said that you were a television writer I'd met when he had gone to America.
Well, that's true enough.
Yes, and then I said I saw you again before you went back to New York, and you promised to look us up if ever you came back.
I see.
Now, Matt, I know you think it's silly, but... when you get to know Tony, you'll understand why.
Margo, I gotta get one thing straight. Things are okay now between you and Tony?
Ugh. They've never been better, and I want to keep them that way.
Well, I'm very glad. At least I guess I will be when I get used to the idea.
And there's something else.
Yes?
I wasn't going to tell you, but...
come on, let's have it.
Well, you remember those letters you wrote me?
Of course.
After I read them, I burned them. I thought it best. All except one. You probably know the one I mean.
I can guess. I never should have written it.
Oh, I know. But I loved it anyway. I used to carry it around with me wherever I went. And then One day, Tony and I were going to visit some friends for the weekend in the country. As we were standing on the platform, I noticed my handbag was missing, and the letter was inside.
I see. Where was this?
Victoria Station. I thought I must have left it in the restaurant, but when I went back to look for it, it had gone.
You never found it?
I recovered the handbag about 2 weeks later from the lost and found, but the letter wasn't there. And then, about 2 weeks after that, I received a note telling me what I was to do to get the letter back.
Go on.
It was to withdraw £50 from my bank in £5 notes and then change them for used £1 notes. It said that if I went to the police or told anyone at all, it would show the letter to my husband.
May I see it? Well, printed in all capitals. Anyone could have done this.
And a week after, I received this one.
Well, both mailed in Brixton. Tie up money in a package and mail to John S. King, 23 Newport Street, Brixton, SW9. You will get your letter by return. Well, of all the...
Well, that's a little short. People use it as a forwarding address.
Did you mail the money?
Yes, but the letter was never returned. So after waiting 2 weeks, I went there. They said they'd never heard of a man by that name, and the parcel was still there.
Well, I suppose that's something. May I keep these?
Yes, if you like.
You didn't tell Tony?
No, I didn't tell anyone. I can't imagine why the man didn't collect the money.
Well, he was probably in jail by that time. You never heard from him again?
No.
Well, let me know if you do, because I'll find him and I'll fix him so he can neither read, let alone write. Is that why you asked me to stop writing?
Yes. I was in an awful panic. I imagined that every letter you wrote me would be opened and read by someone.
Why didn't you tell me?
Oh, you couldn't have done anything. You probably would have made me go to the police and tell Tony. It was only £50. I figured I'd just pay up and have done with it.
Margot, are you ever going to tell Tony about us?
No, I couldn't possibly. Not now.
Well, why not? Don't you think we'd all get on better?
Yes. I know Tony. You don't.
You don't have to tell me. Just the thought of meeting him makes me, shall we say, uncomfortable.
Oh, you'll get on fine. Tony's changed a lot this last year. Now he's a model husband. In fact, it was exactly a year ago that it happened.
What happened?
Tony suddenly grew up. He seemed to change overnight from a rather selfish little person into a perfectly reasonable grown-up. You remember that night. I came to say goodbye.
Well, how could I forget? Tony had gone off to play in a tennis tournament.
Yes, he did. But he came back. After I left you that night, I came back here and I sat down on the sofa. I had a good cry. Then I fell asleep. When I woke up, Tony was standing in the hallway with all of his bags and tennis rackets. He said that he'd decided to give up tennis for good and just settle down.
Just like that?
Just like that. Well, I couldn't believe it myself at first. I'd gotten so used to tagging around after him, I could see no end in sight. But he meant it all right. The very next day, he went out and got himself a job. Exactly a year ago.
Well, I was putting the mushrooms into the spaghetti. I nearly turned around and said, I can't go through with this, Margot. Let's find Tony and have it out with him.
I know. I felt that way too. But all I could do was stand there quite uselessly with a drip on the end of my nose. What did you do after I had gone?
Well, I walked along the embankment, stared at the Chelsea gas works.
Were you thinking of the gas works or me?
Neither. I was writing a story. I always do when I'm miserable.
A sad story?
Well, a triumphant one. My hero was an eminent writer, coming from America, with his pocket full of money, ready to snatch his lady love from the arms of her jealous husband.
Only to find that husband and wife were perfectly happy, thank you very much.
And that he was very glad to know it.
Oh, Max, let's drink to the way things turn out.
The way things turn out.
The boss blew in just as I was leaving.
Oh, Tony, this is Max Halligan.
Hello, Max.
Tony.
Has Margot been looking after you all right? How's your drink?
We've been drinking ourselves silly waiting for you.
How do you like it over here, Max?
Fine.
Is this your first visit to London?
Well, no, actually. I was here a year ago for a vacation.
Oh, that's right. Margot told me. You write for the, radio, don't you?
Television.
Ah, yes. Television. Poor fellow. Are you staying long?
I'm not sure. I have some writing to do. When that's finished, I'd like to stay a while longer and maybe do some traveling.
Oh, that's a good idea. Only don't spend all your time in museums and cathedrals. Once you've seen one, you've seen the lot, if you ask me. Oh, do you fish?
No, I'm afraid I don't.
Oh, what a pity. If you did, I'd suggest you went up to Scotland.
He doesn't fish, darling.
Well, no, he doesn't. That's that. I say, if you want to show him around any time, just let us know. Margot, we could take him to the Tower of London.
I'm afraid I've already been there.
Oh, what a pity. I've always wanted to go to the Tower. But seriously, if there's anything we can do, any time.
Thank you, Tony. I'll remember that.
Oh, darling, did you make the reservation?
Yes, 7 o'clock.
Well, come on, get your coat on.
Oh, darling, a slight alteration in plans.
Oh, now don't say you can't go.
Afraid so. Old man Burgess is flying to Brussels on Sunday. We all have to get our end of month reports in by tomorrow.
Well, can't you do it when you came back tonight?
Afraid not. It will take me hours. I shall have to fake half of it.
Well, will you join us afterwards? We might go somewhere.
Give me a ring if you finish. If I'm inspired, I might make it.
Do try. I'll just keep my veins, Max.
Oh, here are the tickets, Max.
Thanks.
I'm afraid this is rather rude of me.
Not at all. I'm sorry you can't come, though.
You must come to dinner one night.
Well, thanks, I'd like to.
I say, are you doing anything tomorrow night?
Saturday, I don't think so.
Oh, splendid. How would you like to go to a stag party just down the road?
A stag party?
Yes, a couple of American boys have been playing tennis all over the continent. Well, we're giving them a sort of a, fond farewell.
Well, but I'm no tennis player.
Well, that doesn't matter. You know New York and all that. Oh, darling, Max is coming to the party tomorrow.
Oh, good. You'll want to stop by here first for a drink?
That's the idea.
By the way, aren't you dressing?
Yes, dinner jackets. Is that all right, Max?
Well, no, actually. My trunk was supposed to arrive today, but it hasn't.
Oh, well, you could always rent one, of course.
Oh, don't be silly. It isn't that important.
Hold on. I think I've got an idea.
No, we really are going to be late.
Shall I try to get a taxi?
No, we can usually get one. Tell me, darling.
Hold on a minute. Here, Max, try this on.
What on earth?
Well, it's only my old single-breasted, but it might do.
Look, if dressing is as important as all this, let's forget it, shall we?
Nonsense.
Oh, that old thing, it reeks of mothballs.
Well, they say a writer will do anything for a square meal.
It does look a little meager, doesn't
yes,
it?
Yes, I refuse to let you send Max out of here looking like a scarecrow. Surely he can go as he is.
Anyway, my stuff ought to be here by tomorrow. Let's just hope that it is.
Let's go, Max, before he tries the pants on.
All right, you two. Well, goodbye. Enjoy yourselves. Oh, Max.
Yes?
Try and sell the odd ticket and have a drink on the proceeds. said 2837.
Yes.
May I speak to Captain Leskett?
Speaking.
Oh, hello. You don't know me. My name is Fisher. I understand you have a car for sale.
An American car?
Yes, that's the one. How much are you asking?
$1,100.
I see. It does look just the job, but I'm afraid I don't like that price very much.
I didn't like it when I bought it.
Now, when can we meet?
About more than that.
No, I don't think I can make that. No, I can't, and I'm going to Liverpool on Sunday. I was wondering... I say, I don't suppose you could come round to my house this evening.
Where
is it? Maida Vale. I'd call on you, only I've twisted my knee rather badly.
Oh, I'm sorry. What's your address?
61A Charrington Gardens.
Harrison?
No, Charrington.
Charrington?
Yes, turn left to the underground. It's 2 minutes walk.
I'll be there in about an hour.
About an hour, that's so good of you. Oh, by the way, will you be bringing the car?
I'm afraid I can't. I can go
to the... Oh, that's all right. I've had a good look at it. But if you bring the passbook and the papers, I don't see why we couldn't set this up tonight.
Of course.
Providing you drop the price sufficiently.
I'm afraid that's quite out of the question.
Well, we'll see what a couple of drinks can do. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Captain.
Mr. Fisher!
Yes, Captain Leslie.
Yes.
This is so good of you to come in. Let me have your coat. Have any trouble finding the place?
None at all.
Oh. Do sit down.
Thank you.
Now, how about a drink? Last year.
Well, this is a coincidence.
Well, this calls for a special drink. I was planning to palm you off with an indifferent port, but let's see what we've got here, shall we? Ooh, how about this?
Perfect. By the way, how did you know my car was for sale?
Your garage told me.
That's odd. I don't recall mentioning it to anyone there.
Yes, I stopped in for a fill-up. I happened to mention I was looking for an American car, and they gave me your number. I say, it is for sale, isn't it?
Well, of course.
Oh, good. But I refuse to discuss price until you've had at least 3 brandies.
I warn you, I drive a hard bargain, drunk or sober.
So do I.
You know, I swear, I must have seen you somewhere since Cambridge.
Ever been to Wimbledon?
Wendy's. That's it! Tony Wendy's! Then what's all this about Fisher?
What's all this about Lesgit? Do you like a cigar?
I'll stick to this pipe if you don't mind.
Oh. Well, that's one habit you've changed. Yes, I remember back at school, you always used to smoke rather expensive cigars.
Wait a minute.
Oh, I think I've got a photograph of it here somewhere. Let's see. Yes. Yes, look, here's the photo taken at an old reunion dinner. Well, there you are on the right, smoking the biggest cigar in the business.
That was the first and last reunion I ever went to. What a murderous thug I look.
Yes, you do, rather. Of course, I always remember you because of the college ball. You were the, treasurer.
Honorary treasurer. I used to organize some beastly things.
Yes, I remember some of the ticket money was stolen.
Yes, nearly £100. I left the cash box in my back study, and when I went to sleep, in the morning, the money was gone. Still makes me sweat to think about it.
It was the college porter, of course.
Yes, poor old Alfred. Never could back a winner. They found the cash box in his back garden.
But not the money.
Good Lord, 20 years!
What are you doing nowadays?
I work in property. I say, I didn't follow tennis very closely. Did you play Wimbledon this year?
Oh, no. I've given up tennis. Or rather, tennis has given me up. Oh, I've had a good run for my money, though. I went around the world 3 times. Oh.
I imagine you were treated like a film star.
No. Film stars get paid.
There is that.
I managed to save a little on expenses. In about 7 years, I put away just over £1,000. Not much compared with your film stars.
What are you doing now? Making up for lost time?
I sell sports equipment. Not very lucrative. But it gives me plenty of spare time.
Well, I'm here to tell you, you managed to run a very comfortable place.
Well, my wife has some money of her own. Otherwise, I should hardly feel like blowing £1,000 on your car.
£1,100. Yes, people with capital don't realize how fortunate they are. I've already resigned into getting by on what I can earn.
Of course, you could still marry for money.
Yes, I suppose there are those who make a business of that.
I know I do.
You mean that the woman you fell in love with had some money of her own?
No. No, I always intended to marry for money. I had to. Whilst I was in first-class tennis, I met wealthy people all over the world. So I decided to snap up the first chance I got. I nearly married a tubby Boston Deb worth $5 million. It got as far as pictures in the papers. Until she threw me over for an heir to a chain of grocery stores. Funny how they all stick together. No, I decided to settle for a good deal less, a lot more easily. My wife had been a fan of mine for some time.
Well, that's putting it rather bluntly.
Have I shocked you?
No. I always admire a man who knows what he wants.
To know what he wants to pay for. That's the thing. Everything has its price. So many people fail nowadays because they want to buy cheap. I've learned to pay a big price for anything I really want. I usually get it.
Yes, I'm sure you do. I haven't a great deal of...
I was telling you about my wife. She got her money from her late aunt, who got it from her late husband, who got it from his first wife. Of course, a good chunk gets lopped off every time somebody dies, but a good deal has managed to filter through.
Well, you say you married her for money. Why do you suppose she married you?
I was a tennis star. She never would have married a commercial salesman.
But you've given up tennis. She hasn't left you yet.
She nearly did.
Let me, Wendis. You've got a groggy need.
Oh, thanks, old boy. Let's just have the bottle over here, shall we?
Good idea.
Would you like to hear about it?
Hear what?
About my wife. How she nearly left me.
It's your privilege. You're the host.
Well, to be frank, I think you may be able to help. Just man-to-man advice, you know.
I am at your service.
When first we were married, I used to play in the various championships, and Margot used to travel around with me. I think she found it all a bit much. A hospitality outside of this country can be pretty exhausting. When we got back, she pleaded with me to give up tennis and play husband instead. In the end, we compromised. I went alone to America for the grass court seasons, and she stayed here. After the championships, I returned, but I soon realized that things had changed. For starters, she wasn't in love with me anymore. There were phone calls that would end abruptly if I happened to walk in, and there was an old school friend that she suddenly would visit from time to time. And then one day we had a row. I wanted to play in a covered court tournament, and as usual, she didn't want me to go. I was in the bedroom. The phone rang. It all sounded a bit urgent. After that, she seemed rather keen that I should play in that tournament after all. So I packed my kit into the car and I drove off. I parked my car two streets away and walked back on my tracks. 10 minutes later, she came out of this house and took a taxi. I took another. Her old school friend lived in a studio in Chelsea. I could see them through the studio window as he cooked spaghetti over a gas ring. They didn't say much. They just looked very natural together. Funny how you can tell when people are in love. After that, I started to walk. I began to wonder what would happen if she left me. I'd have to find a way of earning a living to begin with. Suddenly I realized just how much I'd grown to depend upon her. All these expensive tastes I'd acquired while I was at the top. And now first-class tennis had finished with me, and so apparently had my wife. I don't remember ever being so scared. I dropped into a pub for a drink. As I sat in the corner, I thought of, well, all sorts of things. I thought of three different ways of killing him. I even thought of killing her. That seemed a far more sensible idea. And just as I was working out exactly how I could do it, I suddenly saw something which completely changed my mind. I didn't go to that tournament after all. When I got back that night, she was exactly where you are now. I told her I decided to give up tennis and to play husband instead.
Well?
Well, as it turns out, I needn't have got so worked up after all. Apparently, that spaghetti evening had been a sort of, a fond farewell. The boyfriend had been called back to New York.
an American.
Yes.
There were long letters from there. They usually arrived on Thursdays. She burnt all of them, except one. That one she used to transfer from handbag to handbag. It was always with her. That letter became an obsession with me. I had to find out what was in it. And finally, I did. That letter made for very interesting reading.
You mean you stole it?
Yes. I even wrote it to anonymous notes offering to sell it back.
Why?
Oh, because, well, I was hoping that would make her come and tell me all about it. But it didn't. So I've kept the letter.
Why are you telling me all of this?
Because you're the only person that I can trust. Anyway, that must have put the fear of God into them because the letter stopped, and we lived happily ever after. Funny to think that just a year ago, I was sitting in that Knightsbridge pub, actually planning to murder her. And I might have done, had I not seen something that completely changed my mind.
What did you see?
I saw you.
What's so odd about that?
The coincidence. You see, just a week before I'd been to a reunion dinner, and the fellas had been talking about you. About how you'd been, court-martialed during the war, and, spent a year in prison? Well, that was news. Mind you, at college, we always used to say old Swan would end up in jail. That cash box, I suppose.
What about it?
Oh, my dear fellow, everybody knew you took that money. Poor old Alfred.
Well, thanks for the drink. Interesting hearing about your matrimonial affairs. I take it you won't be wanting that car after all.
Don't you want me to tell you why I brought you here?
Yes, I think you better.
It was when I saw you in that pub that everything became quite clear. Just a few months before, Margot and I had made out our wills. Quite short affairs, leaving everything we had to each other in case of accidents. Hers worked over to just over £90,000. Investments, mostly, but all a little too easy to get at, and that was dangerous, as they'd be bound to suspect me. I needed an alibi, a good one, and then I sold you. I'd often wondered what happened to people when they came out of prison. People like you, I mean. Can they find a job? Do old friends rally round? Suppose they've never had any friends. I was so curious to know that I followed you. I followed you home that night. Well, would you mind passing your glass? Thank you. And I've been following you ever since.
Why?
Well, I was hoping that sooner or later I might catch you at something and be able to...
Blackmail me.
Influence you. After a while, I got to know your routine, which made things a lot easier.
Rather dull.
At first, yes. But you know how it is. When you take up a new hobby, the more you find out about it, the more fascinating it becomes. You became quite fascinating. You always went dog racing on Mondays and Thursdays. Oh, I even took it up myself, just to be near you. You had changed your name to Adams.
I got bold with Swan. Any crime in that?
No. None. Then you... Oh, and you always used to eat at that little club. It had a funny name. What was it? Oh yes, the Kettle of Fish. The police closed it down recently, I believe. Someone was caught taking drugs or something.
I wouldn't know about that. I only went there to eat. There's no crime in that, either.
None whatsoever. In fact, there was nothing really illegal about you. I began to get quite discouraged. And then one day, you disappeared from your lodgings. So I phoned your landlady. I said, Mr. Adams owed me £5. Well, apparently that was nothing. It seems Mr. Adams owed her 6 weeks' rent and her best lodger £55. And Mr. Adams had always been such a nice gentleman. That's what seemed to upset her the most.
Yes. That's what always upsets them the most.
Oh, I say, old boy, if you want another drink, would you mind putting on these gloves? Thanks. Now, where were we? Oh, yes, I'd lost you. And then I found you one day at dog racing, where I then tailed you home to your new address in Carlisle Court. Mr. Adams had become Mr. Wilson.
This is all most fascinating. Do go on.
Mr. Wilson disappeared from those lodgings last July, owing 15 weeks' rent, and somewhat richer for his brief encounter with a Miss Wallace. You used to go out with Miss Wallace on Sundays and Wednesdays. She certainly was in love with you, wasn't she? I suppose she thought you were growing that handsome mustache to please her. Poor Miss Wallace.
Do continue.
July, August, September. 127. I already said Carlisle Court, but I'll have to say it again. I'll have to pick it up. 127 Carlisle Court. Occupant, a Mrs. Van Dorn. Mrs. Van Dorn's late husband left her two hotels and a large apartment house fully furnished. What a base to operate from. Captain Lesgett. The only trouble is, Mrs. Van Dorn does so rather enjoy being courted, and she is so very expensive. Perhaps that's why you've been trying to sell her car for over a month.
Mrs. Van Dorn asked me to sell it for her.
I know. I called her up just before you arrived. She only wanted 800.
Where's the nearest police station?
Just opposite the church, 2 minutes' walk.
Suppose I walk there now.
What would you tell them?
Everything.
Everything? All about Mr. Adams and Mr. Wilson?
I shall simply tell them that you are trying to blackmail me into...
Into?
Murdering your wife.
I rather wish you would. When she heard that, we'd have the biggest laugh of our lives.
You've forgotten something.
Have I?
You've told me a few things here tonight.
What of it?
Suppose I tell them how you followed them to that apartment in Chelsea. How you watched them cooking spaghetti, all that rubbish. Wouldn't that ring a bell?
It certainly would. They'd naturally assume you followed her there yourself.
Me? Why should I?
Why should you steal their handbag? Why should you write her those blackmail notes? Can you prove that you didn't? You certainly can't prove I did. It would be a straight case of your word against mine.
That ought to confuse them. What could you say?
I should simply tell them that you came here tonight, half drunk, wanting to borrow money on the strength that we were at college together. When I refused, you started saying something about a letter belonging to my wife. As far as I could make out, you were offering to sell it back. I gave you what little money I had, and you gave me the letter. It has your fingerprints on it. Remember? I shall then say that you threatened that if I went to the police, that you would tell them some fool story about my wanting you to murder my wife. But before we go on, old chap, do consider the inconvenience. You see, I am quite well known, and there would be pictures of you as well. Sooner or later, a deputation of lodgers and landladies would come forth to testify to your character. And someone is certain to have seen you with Miss Wallace. I did notice you were always careful not to be seen with Miss Wallace. Always took her to out-of-the-way places where you wouldn't be recognized. Like that little tea shop on Pimlico.
That was her idea, not mine.
Yes, it was a bit crummy, wasn't it? Hardly a place to take Mrs. Van Dorn. Oh, by the way, you were planning on marrying Mrs. Van Dorn, were you not?
Smart, aren't you?
No, not really. I just had time to think things out. Put myself in your position. And that's why I know you're going to agree.
What makes you think I'll agree?
For the same reason that a donkey with a stick behind him and a carrot in front goes forwards and not backwards.
Tell me about the carrot.
£1,000 cash.
For a murder?
For a few minutes' work. That's all it is. And very little risk, I guarantee. Now that ought to appeal to you, since you've been skating on rather thin ice.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Well, you should know. It was in all the papers. A middle-aged woman found dead due to an overdose of cocaine. Seems she'd been taking this stuff for quite some time, but no one knows where she got it. But we know, don't we? Poor Miss Wallace. Yes, you should take a long holiday abroad. I think you'll find that a honeymoon with Mrs. Van Dorn would be quite preferable to 10 years detention at Dartmoor. My £1,000 should see you safely married to her. You'll find it makes quite a difference to have some money in the family.
This £1,000, where is it?
It's in an attaché case in a check room.
Where?
Somewhere in London. Of course, we don't meet again. Once you've, delivered the goods, I shall mail you the key to the case and the check room ticket. You can take this £1,000 on account.
Honor.
The police.
It's inflation. You can take this £100 on account.
The police would only have to trace one of these notes back to you, and they would hang us both with the same rope.
They won't. For a whole year, I've been cashing an extra £20 a week, all in fivers. I then change them for these at my leisure.
Let me see your bank statement.
Of course. Don't touch.
Turn back the page. Your balance has decreased by £1,000 over the last year. Suppose the police ask about that.
I go dog racing twice a week.
They'll check with your bookmaker.
Like you, I always bet on the tote. Satisfied.
When would this take place?
Tomorrow night.
Tomorrow? Not a chance. I've got to think this over.
But it's got to be tomorrow. I've arranged things that way.
Where?
Approximately where you're standing now.
How?
Tomorrow night, Halliday, that's the American boyfriend, and I will go to a stag party just down the road. Margot will remain here. She'll go to bed early and listen to Saturday Night Theater on the radio. She always does. When I'm out. At exactly 23 minutes to 11, you will enter this house by the street door. You'll find the key to this door. Under the stair carpet, here.
The fifth step.
That's the one. You will come straight.
straight to the window and hide behind the curtains. At 20 minutes to 11, I shall go to the phone in the hotel to call my boss. I shall dial the wrong number. This number. When she gets up to answer the phone, you'll see the light come on under the bedroom door. When she opens the door, the light is still across the floor, so don't move until she answers the phone. There must be as little noise. When it's done, pick up the phone and give me a soft whistle. Then hang up. Don't speak, whatever you do. I shan't say a word. When I've got your signal, I shall hang up and redial the correct number this time, and then speak to my boss as if nothing has happened.
What happens then? Go on!
You'll find this suitcase here. It will contain some clothes of mine for the cleaners. Open it, tip the clothes out onto the floor, and then fill it with the antique cigarette box and these cups here. Do not snap the locks, and leave it just as it is now.
As if I left in a hurry.
That's the idea. Now, the window. If it's closed, open it, and leave it open. And then go out exactly the way you came in.
By this door?
Yes, and here's the most important thing. Here's the most important thing. On your way out, put the key back exactly where you found it.
Under the stair part?
Yes.
What exactly is supposed to have happened here?
They'll assume you broke in through these windows, thinking the apartment empty. You took the suitcase and went to work. When she heard the noise, she turned on the light. When you saw it under the bedroom door, you hid behind the curtains. When she came in here...
Yes! I'm supposed to have entered by the window. What if the window had been locked?
That's not the line.
Yeah?
It wouldn't matter.
It wouldn't matter. That's when you started.
Oh, shit. Yeah, okay, I'm sorry.
You were right. You got screwed up by now. I was supposed to have entered by the window. What if the window had been locked?
It wouldn't matter. You see, she often takes a walk around the garden before she goes to bed. And she often forgets to lock up afterwards. That's what I shall tell the police.
But she may say
that... But she isn't going to say anything.
Is there any reason why I shouldn't leave by the garden?
Yes, you'd have to climb an iron gate. If you were spotted, you could be followed.
Okay. I leave the flat by this door, putting the key back under the stair carpet, and going out by the street door. What if the street door had been locked? How would I have gotten in the first place?
The street door is never locked.
What time will you return?
Around 12. I shall bring Halliday back for a nightcap, so we shall find her together. And we will have been together ever since we left her. And there's my alibi.
You're forgetting something.
Oh, am I?
When you return with this Halliday, how will you get into the apartment?
I shall let myself in.
But your key will be under the stair carpet, and when you take it out, he's bound to see you, and that will give the whole thing away.
No! It won't be my key under the stair carpet. It will be hers. I shall take it out of her handbag before I leave and place it out there. Then, when we get back, while Halliday is searching the garden or something, I shall put it back in her handbag before the police arrive.
How many keys are there to this door?
Just hers and mine. Maybe Vale 0407. Oh, hello, darling. How's it going? Oh, I'm so sorry. I mean, I'm glad.
How are you?
Oh, very sleepy. I've just made myself some coffee to try and stay awake. Oh, hold on a moment, darling. I think there's somebody at the door. Careful. You can be seen from the bedroom window. Sorry, darling, my mistake.
You will join us, won't you?
Oh, I'm afraid not. I hardly seem to have started.
Oh, Tony. You can't let go now, don't
it? We will manage it one day.
I say, darling.
Yes?
It seems all day, but would you mind if Max and I meet somewhere afterwards?
Of course. What do you want to do? Dance?
Oh.
Take him to Jerry's.
How do we meet him?
Just mention my name. I'm not sure about the band, but the food's good. Oh, darling, Maureen rang up just after you left. Wants us to go to dinner on Wednesday night. You've got something written in your diary here, but I can't read your writing. Is this something about Al Bentall? Who's he? Another of your boyfriends?
Albert Hall, you
mean? Oh, Albert Hall, of course. Oh, thank heavens we can't go to Maureen. She's such a filthy cook.
Oh, there. I must try.
All right, darling. Have fun. Ta-ta.
Well?
After that, he lost all concentration and never won another game.
Where is the picture of the Maharaja?
Well, I don't know. It's somewhere among those loose ones.
Darling, when are you going to get around to pasting in those press clippings?
I shall find the time. One of these days. Oh, here he is. There's the Maharaja. Isn't he dreamy?
Yes, he had four Rolls Royces. And enough jewels to sink a battleship, but all he really wanted was to play at Wimbledon.
Yes, the poor darling, he was so short-sighted, he could hardly see the end of his racket, let alone the ball.
Really are writing a book about all this.
Why don't you two collaborate? A detective novel with a tennis background.
Oh, murder on the center court.
What about you, Max? Will you provide me with the perfect murder?
I think I'd like better, Tony.
How do you start to write a detective story?
Well, you forget the detection, then concentrate on the crime. The crime is the thing. Just imagine you're gonna steal something or murder somebody.
Is that what you do? Interesting.
Well, I just put myself in the criminal's shoes, and then I keep saying, well, what do I do next?
Do you really believe in the perfect murder?
Absolutely, on paper. And I think I could plan one out better than most people. But I doubt I can carry it out.
Why not?
Well, because things in stories turn out as the author plans them to. In real life, they don't always. I imagine my murders be rather like my bridge play. I'd make some damn stupid mistake and I wouldn't realize it until I found that everyone was looking at me.
Oh dear, we'd better drink up, Max.
All right, sir.
Are you doing anything tomorrow?
No, I don't think so.
I think we should all drive down to Windsor for lunch.
Oh, that's a good idea. Come around early. Oh, no, not too early. We may be nursing a hangover.
About 11.
Oh, that sounds perfect. By the way, darling, did I mention my latchkey? I can't find it anywhere.
Oh, I may have them both in my handbag. I'll just go check.
Oh, dear. It's raining rather hard. I can lend you a raincoat, if that's any good.
This'll do. It isn't far, is it?
I just round the corner.
I only have one here. Are you sure yours isn't in your own?
No, I've looked there, but...
I know I don't like thrillers when I'm alone.
Oh.
Anyway, I should be back before you, and I can just let you in.
Well, we may be back rather late. You may be asleep by then.
You can always leave your key under the proverbial mat.
Oh, no, it's all right. I have it here in my glove.
Oh, well, that settles that.
Oh, what movie are you going to?
The classic, I expect.
I should have taken that off with me when I went. Will you get in Saturday night?
I can always try, but... Don't make me stay home. You know how I hate doing nothing.
Nothing?
Why, there's hundreds of things you can do. Have you written to Peggy about last weekend? And what about those clippings, darling? It seems like an ideal opportunity.
I like that. You two go gallivanting about while I'm stuck at home working on those boring clippings.
Oh, well. All right, fine. We won't go.
What do you mean?
Oh, I mean, it's obvious you don't want us to go out, so we won't. We'll stay here with you. What shall we do? Play cards?
Now tell me, darling.
I should call the Brendan and tell them we're not coming.
Tony, let's not be childish about this. I'll do your old clippings.
You don't have to if you don't want to.
Oh, but I do want to. Have we any paste?
And the desk, I should think.
Oh, and the scissors in the mending box. Oh, the paste tube is empty. It won't be. Never mind, I'll just see if Mrs. Lucas has some.
Who's she?
Oh, she lives just across the road. I'll just drop by later.
Why not make some? All you need is some flour and some starch.
Oh, that's a good idea. Do you know how to do it?
In two shakes.
Oh, good old Max. I'm sorry, darling. Was I very unreasonable?
It's all right. I tell you what. I'll do these clippings if you put up the shelf in the kitchen as you promised.
First thing tomorrow, I promise. Mm-hmm.
Where's the starch?
I'll show you.
If it starts to thicken, add a little water and keep stirring.
All right, well, keep the fire in for us, darling.
Yes, I will.
All right. Oh, it's possible that old man Burgess may phone. If he does, just tell him up at the Brendan.
What's the number?
It's in the book.
Well, you two look out for each other.
We will. Good night, Margo.
Good night, Max. Oh, and you will drive Max home afterwards?
Well, of course. We may stop in for a night nap. Are you sure you want me up?
I shall be fast asleep, and I don't want to be disturbed.
Oh, then we'll be as quiet as mice. Mm-hmm. Shh. Good night. Come on, Max.
Thank you.
No. He's dead. He's dead. Tony, are you there?
Father.
Yes.
That is very clear.
Yes. I'm listening.
Don't touch anything. I'll be with you in a minute.
No, I won't.
Don't touch anything and don't speak to anybody until I get back.
I won't touch anything.
You promise?
Yes, I promise. Just please be quick.
It's all right, I'm here. I'm here. What happened?
He got something around my throat. I think it was a stocking.
Perhaps I better call a doctor.
He's dead.
Yes. When he fell, he must have driven those scissors right through himself.
Oh, how horrible. Could you?
Oh, yes, of course.
Thank you.
No, I didn't know what happened, so I just said I wasn't feeling well. I sent him home. Operator, get me the Maidenvale Police Department, quickly. Go back to bed, darling. I'm sure you did. Someone come quickly. There's been an accident, a ghastly accident.
Yes, sir?
A man broke in and attacked my wife. And I'm afraid he's been killed.
Your name, sir?
Wendis.
D-I-O.
D-I-C-E.
Your address, sir?
61A Charrington Gardens. It's the ground floor apartment. About 10 minutes ago. Yes, I'll tell you all about it. Just get here. How long will that take?
About 2 minutes.
2 minutes. All right, thank you.
Touch anything, will you, sir?
Oh, no, we won't touch anything. Yes. Goodbye. About to have two stockings. In a minute, darling.
More coffee?
No, thank you.
We better call Max and tell him.
I did. He's on his way over.
Did he enjoy the party last night?
Oh, he certainly did. He made a remarkably good speech. Except he kept referring to us as limeys. Oh yes, he's all there, isn't he? Where did you dig him up?
Oh, I met him at Peggy's once, and then I met him again just before he went back to New York.
Oh yes, so you told me. Oh, by the way, oh, sorry.
Oh, no, go on.
I've closed the shutters in the bedroom, is all.
Oh, why?
People are starting to go out for their Sunday papers, and we'll soon have a collection of refined snoopers.
Oh, how awful. Is it in the papers already?
I don't think so. Not for a day or two. What were you going to say?
Oh, I can't remember. It's gone for the moment.
Oh. Hello? This is Mr. Wendis.
Oh, good evening, sir. I'm with the assistant. May I speak with Mrs. Wendis for a
few minutes? No, I'm sorry. My wife won't be seeing anybody, not for a day or two.
Oh, was she hurt in any
way? No, she's all right now.
I just want one or two photographs.
No, I'm sorry. That's not.
But surely you can
I'm sorry. Goodbye.
Who was that?
Just a reporter. I wanted to take some photographs of you.
I suppose we should get a lot of that now.
Oh, I'll forget all about it after the inquest is over. So will you.
When will it be?
The inquest? Well, tomorrow or Tuesday, I should imagine.
What will happen?
The coroner will probably congratulate you on putting up such a good show.
For killing a man?
Now, don't start getting ideas like that. It was him or you. As the police surgeon said, it was lucky those scissors were on the desk.
Why were the police here so long last night?
Were they? I didn't notice. I'm afraid I dropped off rather quickly.
Oh, I know you did, but cars kept coming and going all night.
I only met the sergeant. Nice chap. Seemed to have everything under control.
At one point, I thought they were turning all the furniture around.
Oh, they haven't made much of a mess. Oh, look, they've even emptied the waste paper basket. That was thoughtful of them.
And someone kept shining a light under the bedroom door.
Oh, taking photographs, I suspect.
About 2 o'clock, I had enough. I got up and I came in here.
You came in here? What for?
To ask them when they expected to finish. But when I saw them, I couldn't say anything. 2 men were on the floor with a tape measure. Another one was outside, opening and closing the window. They all stopped what they were doing and looked at me. I felt such a fool. And on the desk were a pair of shoes. His, I suppose. Oh, it was just awful.
Oh, darling, before I forget, the sergeant wanted to know why you didn't phone the police straight away.
You told me not to.
Well, I know, but
You distinctly told me not to speak to anyone.
I know, but I told him a slightly different story.
Why?
I simply said that you didn't phone the police because you naturally assumed I would phone them from the hotel.
Why did you say that?
Well, because it was a perfectly reasonable explanation, and he accepted it. You see, if they got the slightest idea we had delayed reporting it, even for a few minutes, they might get nosy and start asking
and
a lot of
you
questions.
You want me to say the same thing?
I think so, yes. Just in case it comes up again, I suspect that's Max. Let him in while I get rid of these.
May I come in?
Oh, yes, of course. I'll just tell my husband that you're here.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning, sir. I'm Chief Inspector Hubbard. I'm in charge of the criminal investigation of this division.
Well, I think I gave your sergeant all the necessary information.
Yes, I've seen his report, of course, but there are a few things I like to get first hand. I gather my sergeant only saw you for a few moments, Mrs. Wendis. Mrs. Wendis?
Oh, yes.
My wife was suffering from considerable shock.
Yes, that was a very nasty experience you had. Mind if I take a look around?
Well, of course. The bedroom and bathroom are through here.
Certainly didn't get in by the bathroom.
No, and the kitchen has bars on the windows. We assume he came in through these windows.
I understand you weren't here when this happened, sir?
No, I was at a dinner party at the Brendan Hotel.
Just down the road?
Yes, by a curious coincidence, I happened to be phoning my wife when she was attacked.
So I gather. Can you tell me exactly what time it was?
Oh, well, I'm not sure.
Did you notice Mrs. Wendis?
Oh, no, I didn't.
You phoned the police at 11:03, sir.
Oh, well, let's see, then it must have been about 11:15. Oh, by the way, won't you sit down, sir?
Thank you.
Have you any idea who he was?
Yes.
At least we've discovered where he lived. There still seems to be some confusion as to his real name.
Oh.
He appeared to have several. Have you ever seen him before?
No, of course not. Oh, is this him?
Yes. You don't recognize him?
No, I never saw him.
Didn't you even catch a glimpse of his face?
Well, no. You see, he attacked me from behind and it was dark and I hardly saw him at all.
But before I showed you these photographs, you said you had never seen him before. How could you know that if you never saw his face last night?
Inspector, my wife simply meant that as far as she knew, she had never seen him before.
Was that what you meant?
Yes, I'm sorry, yes.
How about you, sir? Ever seen him before?
No. No, only...
Yes?
Well, it's rather like someone I was at college with. The mustache makes quite a difference.
What was his name?
Now you're asking. It's nearly 20 years since I left.
Was it Lesgate?
No.
Wilson?
No.
Swan?
No, wait a minute. Swan? Yes. Yes, that's it, Swan. I think I have an old photo taken at a reunion dinner. Yes! Oh! Yes, here he is. Here, on the right. It's unbelievable.
Did you know him well?
No, he was senior to me.
Have you met him since then?
No. Well, at least, I did see him recently. But not to speak to.
When was that?
Oh, let's see. About 6 months ago, I saw him at a railway station. Waterloo, I think.
Mrs. Wendis, would you show me exactly what happened last night?
Oh, Tony, do I have to?
I'm afraid so, darling.
Oh. Well, I was in bed and the phone rang. I came in here.
Did you switch this light on?
No.
Just show me exactly where you stand.
I stood here and I picked up the phone.
Are you sure you had your back to the window like that?
Yes, quite sure.
But why?
Why not?
Why go around the desk? I should have picked it up from this side.
Surely my wife can remember.
Just a moment, sir.
I always answer the phone like this, with my left hand, in case I should want to write something down.
I see. All right. Go on.
I picked up the phone, and he must have come from behind the curtain and attacked me. He got something around my throat.
Something? What do you mean by something?
I think it was a scarf.
I see. What happened then?
He attacked me and he pushed me down on the desk, and I distinctly remember feeling for the scissors.
Where were those scissors usually kept?
In an ending basket. I'd forgotten to put them away.
Now, what makes you think he came from behind those curtains?
Where else would he be?
The curtains were drawn, I suppose?
Yes.
Do you draw them yourself?
I drew them, Inspector, before I went out.
Did you lock the window at the same time?
Yes.
Are you quite sure of that?
Yes, very sure. I always lock up when I draw the curtains.
Then how do you suppose he got into this room?
Well, we assume that he broke in.
There's no sign of a break-in. The lock's quite undamaged.
But he must have done. Unless... Margot, did you go out into the garden last night at all and forget to lock up afterwards?
After he attacked me, I wanted to get some air, so I pushed this window open and I stood on the terrace outside.
Did you call for help?
No.
You say you pushed the window open. Are you sure you didn't unlock it first?
Yes, quite sure.
Was it already open?
No.
Mrs. Wendis.
Yes.
Perhaps.
And I didn't call the doctor because the man was dead.
I see.
Did you take a pulse?
Did you check? Did it not occur to you to call for a doctor?
No.
Why ever not?
Because he was dead.
How did you know that?
It was obvious.
Did you check his pulse?
No, of course not. Anyone could tell that he was dead. Just one look at those staring eyes.
So you did see his face after all?
I saw his eyes. I can't remember his face.
Inspector, it is quite obvious that my wife had never seen this man before. And if he didn't get in through these windows, how did he get in?
As a matter of fact, we're quite certain that he came in by that door.
But that door is locked.
Margot? Did you go out after he left and forget to close the door up?
No.
How many keys are there to this door?
Just two. Mine was in my handbag and my husband had his with him.
No, that's right. Has the caretaker got a key?
No.
Do you employ a charwoman?
Yes, but she hasn't got one either and I always hear when she comes.
Inspector. What makes you think he came in through that door?
His shoes.
His shoes?
The ground was soaking wet last night. If he'd come in by that door, he would have left marks all over the carpet. He didn't leave any because he wiped his shoes off on the front doormat.
How can you tell?
It's a fairly new mat, and some of the fibers came off on his shoes.
Oh, but surely that...
And there was a small tar stain on the mat, and some of the fibers show that as well. There's no question about it.
Hold on. I think I've got it. You remember when you lost your bag?
Yes.
Wasn't your key inside?
Yes, but it was there when it was returned.
Just a minute. I would like to hear about this.
What sort of bag?
A handbag, Inspector. My wife lost it at Victoria Station.
Yes, but I recovered the handbag about 2 weeks later.
Was anything missing?
All the money had gone.
Anything else?
No.
No papers or letters?
No.
Are you quite sure of that?
Yes.
And your latch key was in your handbag when you lost it?
Yes, but it was still there when it was returned.
But whoever stole that money could have had the key copied.
I see. Well, where was this bag found eventually?
Victoria Station.
But not until several weeks later. By which time, he could have had the key copied. And return the original to the handbag.
I see. He could have had your key copied, and he could have used it to open this door. But of course he didn't.
Why not?
Because if he had, the key would have still been on him when he died. But no key was found when we went through his pockets.
I see. Well, we seem to be back where we started.
Not quite. You say you saw this man at Waterloo Station.
Yes.
Are you sure it wasn't Victoria?
It may have been. Yes. Yes. When was it you lost that bag? Wasn't it that weekend we went to see Peggy? Yes, it was Victoria Station. I remember. It was in the restaurant. You were with me, of course, don't you remember? I said something to you about, there's somebody I was at college with.
I can't remember.
Was that where you left your handbag?
Yes, it was. Well, this is extraordinary.
It looks as if he may have had something to do with that handbag after all. The next thing is to get all of this down on paper.
Oh.
I'd like each of you to make official statements before the inquest. My office is only a few minutes from here. Perhaps you could come now.
Oh, excuse me.
Hello, Tony. Margo?
Max, this is Inspector Halliday. This is Inspector Hubbard. This is Mr. Halliday. He was with me last night.
How do you do, Mr. Halliday? As you were with Mr. Windus last night, you may be able to help us here. Can you tell me exactly what time it was when he went to the phone?
Yes, it was about 20 to 11.
And how did you come to notice that?
Well, when Mr. Windus got up from the table, I thought for a moment we were leaving the party, so I looked at my watch.
Thank you, sir. You see, it was when Mrs. Windus came in here to answer his call that she was attacked.
You mean you were phoning Margo?
Yes.
But I don't get this. I asked you if we were leaving, and you said you were going out to phone your boss?
Tony, I remember what I was going to ask you. Why did you phone me last night?
Now, just a minute. Before I lose the thread of this. At about 20 minutes to 11, you left your party to phone your boss.
Yes, I used the payphone in the lobby.
Now, how long were you on the phone with your boss before you called your wife?
Well, as a matter of fact, I never did speak to him. You see, I couldn't remember the number, so I phoned my wife to give it to me out of the address book on the desk.
You mean you hauled me out of bed just to give you his number?
I had to, darling. I'm sorry. You see, he was flying to Brussels this morning, and I needed to remind him of something rather important.
Was there not a telephone directory in the hotel?
He was at home. His home number isn't listed.
So, you never called him after all?
No.
Mr. Halliday, Mr. and Mrs. Windus are coming to my office now to make their statements. Will you give me your address, sir? I may want to get in touch with you.
Certainly.
I'll just get my coat.
Just write it down there, will you? Telephone number as well. Ever been here before, sir?
Yes, about a year ago.
Hmm?
Inspector, there's quite a crowd gathered outside. Can't you send them away?
Oh, they'll come back faster than they go, sir. I was going to suggest we left by the garden. Isn't there a gate at the far end?
Well, yes, but it may still be locked. I'll just check.
How much does he know about you and Mrs. Windus?
What are you talking about?
You wrote a letter to Mrs. Windus from New York. It was found in the dead man's inside pocket. I didn't mention it because I wasn't sure how much Mr. Windus knew. Have you any idea how it got there?
No.
Where's Tony?
He's just gone into the garden.
Mrs. Windus, when you lost your handbag, did you lose a letter as well?
No.
Margot, it was found in this man's pocket.
You did lose it, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
I asked you that before, didn't I?
Yes, you did, but you see, my husband doesn't know about it.
This man was blackmailing you, wasn't he?
It's no good, Margot. Tony will have to know about it now.
No!
It's the only thing to do, Inspector. After Mrs. Windus lost my letter, she received these two notes.
Last February. How many times have you seen this man?
I've never seen him.
Mr. Halliday, I would like you to come along with us.
Yes, of course.
Mrs. Windus, when you come to the police station, there may be other police officers present. I shall warn you first that anything you say will be taken down and may be used in evidence. Now, never mind what you've told me so far. We'll forget about all of that. But from now on, you tell us exactly what you know about this man and exactly what happened last night. And if you try and conceal anything at all, it may put you in a very serious position.
I wish you would explain to me what you mean by all this.
I will. You admit that you killed this man.
You say you did it in self-defense. Unfortunately, there were no witnesses, so we've only your word for that.
But I heard it all, Inspector, through the telephone.
What exactly did you hear, Mr. Wendis?
Well, I heard a thud, and...
Did you hear anything to indicate that a struggle was going on?
Well, what I heard was perfectly in line with what my wife told me had happened.
So all you really know of the matter is what your wife told you, isn't it? You suggest that this man came in to burgle your flat. But there is no evidence of that. There is evidence, however, that this man was blackmailing you.
Blackmail?
It's true, Tony.
You suggest that he came in by the window when we know he came in by that door.
But he can't have gotten in that way. That door is always locked. My husband had his key with him, and mine was in my hand right here.
You could have let him in.
You're not suggesting that she let him in herself.
At present, that appears to be the only way he could have gotten in.
Don't you even believe I was attacked? How do you think I got these bruises on my throat?
You could have caused those bruises yourself. A silk stocking was found outside the window. It had two knots tied in it. Does that mean anything to you?
I suppose that must have been the stocking he used.
We found the twin stocking wrapped in newspaper at the bottom of this waste paper basket. Can you explain why your attacker should do that?
No!
Those stockings were yours, weren't they?
No!
We know they were. One of the heels had been darned with some silk that didn't quite match. We found a reel of that silk in your mending basket.
Tell me, there was a pair of stockings in here.
Well, I've heard of police planting evidence to guarantee a conviction. I just didn't realize they did it in this country.
These men were here all night. They could have done anything with those stockings.
Of course they did, and they wiped his shoes on that mat. Hello, Roger. Tony Wendis here. There's been an attack. There's been an accident, and Margot was attacked.
Margot? What's she
hurt? No, she's all right now, but the man was killed. And you're not going to believe this, but the police are here, and they're actually suggesting that Margot killed the man intentionally.
I wouldn't say that if I were you.
Well, that's a good one.
Yes, it's a laugh, isn't it? Listen, Roger, can you come round to the Maidervale police station immediately?
Be there right away.
Thanks, old man. Don't worry, Roger's on his way.
Mr. Wendis, I should advise you.
Our barrister will give us all the advice we need. Thank you.
Use your back, Marco.
Thank you, Max.
Oh, you are coming, aren't you, sir?
But of course, Inspector.
I see, yes. I just wondered.
Used to it.
I've had to move in here because people kept stopping and staring in the bedroom window. After the appeal failed, they started climbing into the garden. Can't blame them, I suppose. It's cheaper than the zoo and far more topical.
Well, I had to come. In case there was anything.
Shit. I'm afraid it's too late. We received a letter from the Home Secretary this morning.
Well, you mustn't give up trying. It's not over yet.
I'm afraid it is. I went to the prison this morning to say goodbye, but she refused to see me. Actually, I was rather glad. She never did like goodbyes. I shan't see her again.
Tony, I take it you'd do anything to save her life?
Of course.
Even if it meant going to prison for several years?
I'd do absolutely anything.
I think you can. I'm certain. If you tell the police exactly the right story.
The right story?
Listen, Tony, I've been working this out for weeks, just in case it came to this. It may be her only chance.
Well, let's have it.
You'll have to tell the police that you hired Swan to murder her.
What are you talking about?
It's all right, Tony. I've been writing this stuff for years. I know what I'm doing. Margot was only convicted because nobody would believe her story. Prosecution made it out that she was telling one lie after another, and the jury believed him. But what did his case amount to? Only three things. My letter, her stalking, and the idea that because no key was found on Swan, she must have let him in herself. Now Swan is dead. You could tell any story you like about him. You could say you did know him, that you met him, and worked the whole thing out together. Now the blackmail. Swan was only suspected of blackmail for two reasons. Because my letter was found in his pocket, and because you saw him the day Margot's bag was stolen. Well, you can now tell the police that you never saw him, Victoria, that the whole thing was an invention of yours to try and connect him with the letter.
But the letter was found on his body.
Well, because you put it there.
Wait, so you're suggesting I should pretend that I stole Margot's handbag?
Well, sure, you could've.
But why?
Because you wanted to find out who was writing to her. When you read my letter, you were so angry, you decided to teach her a lesson.
But I can't say I wrote those two blackmail notes.
Why not? Nobody can prove that you didn't.
All right, I stole her letter and blackmailed her. What else?
You kept my letter, and you planted it on Swan after he'd been killed.
But when could I have done that?
After you got back from the party, and before the police arrived. At the same time, you took one of Margot's stockings from the mending basket, and then substituted it for whatever Swan had used.
Max, can you imagine anyone actually believing this?
You've got to make them believe it.
Well, I wouldn't know what to say. You'd have to come with me.
No, I couldn't do that. They know the sort of stuff that I write. If they had suspected that we had talked this out, they wouldn't even listen.
Max!
They listen, no, I can't hear.
It's ridiculous. Why should I want anyone to murder Margot?
Oh, one of the stock motives. Had Margot made a will?
Well, yes, I believe she had.
Are you the main beneficiary?
Well, I suppose so.
Well, there you are.
Well, but thousands of husbands and wives leave money to each other without murdering each other. They wouldn't believe a word of it. They'd take it exactly for what it is. A husband desperately trying to save his wife.
Well, it's worth a try. They can't hang you for planning a murder that never came off. Face it, the worst you would get would be a few years in prison.
Oh, thanks very much.
And you would have saved her life? That doesn't seem too big a price.
Well, that's fine coming from you. Her life might not be in danger at all if it hadn't been for you. It was because of your association with her that she lost the sympathy of the jury. It's got to be believable. How would I convince Swan to do a thing like this?
You would have to say You offered him the money.
What money? I haven't got any.
You would have Margot's money.
I wouldn't be able to lay my hands on that for months. And people don't commit murder on a credit. No, I'm sorry, Max. We'll have to come up with something better.
All right. We will. There is an answer. And we've got to find it. How much time have we got?
It's tomorrow morning.
Shh.
Wait a few days.
Yes, sir. I am very conscious of your position. If I may, I would like to say how very sorry I am.
Yes, all right. How can I help you?
A cashier at a factory at Ledbury Street was attacked in his office, and two men made off with several hundred pounds, mostly in pound notes.
Well, what's all this got to do with me?
In cases like this, all police divisions are asked to keep a lookout for anyone spending large sums of money.
I see.
I was wondering if you had sold anything recently for cash.
Why?
My sergeant happened to be making inquiries at Wales Garage the other day. It appeared that you had settled an account there recently for just over £60.
Yes, I happen to have quite a lot on me, so I paid cash.
Had you just drawn this money from your bank?
Have you been to my bank, Inspector?
As a matter of fact, I have. They wouldn't help me. Bank statements are always jealously guarded.
Where'd you get it? Is that any of your business?
If it was stolen money,
yes, sir.
It is my business. Do you mind if I smoke?
Go ahead. Do you really think I've been receiving stolen money?
Well, until you tell where you got it, I shan't know what to think, shall I? You see, if you had got that money from someone you didn't know, well, that may be the very person that we're looking for. Oh, hello. I say, is this yours, sir?
What is it?
Somebody's latchkey. It was lying on the floor just here.
No, I've got mine here.
No, it's not yours. Well, it may be mine then. Ah,
yes,
it is. Why, it must have fallen out of my pocket. There's a small hole there. Well, that's the trouble with those keys. They're all alike. Hmm. I'm sorry, sir. You were saying?
I don't think I was.
Ah, yes. About that money. I'd be grateful if you'd tell me where you got it. After all, £100 is quite a lot to carry around.
You said 60 a moment ago.
Did I? Hmm. Ah, yes. Well, my sergeant did dig a little deeper before he put in his report. It appeared that you had also settled an account, paid a bill at your tailor's, and another for wines and spirits.
Yes. Well, I'm sorry your sergeant went to so much trouble. If he'd come straight to me, I could have explained it straight away. I simply won rather a large sum at dog racing.
Over £100?
Yes, over £100. It has been done before, you know.
I see. Why didn't you tell me this straight away, sir?
Because I'm a little embarrassed to be caught going to dog racing with my wife under sentence of death.
Oh, I know how it is, sir. Helps to take your mind off things. Well, that answers everything, doesn't it? I'm sorry to have had to bother you at this time.
Not at all, Inspector.
Oh, there is just one other thing, sir. Do you have a small brown attaché case?
Um, Don't tell me you found it already.
Why? Have you lost it?
Yes, I was going to report it this afternoon. I believe I left it in a taxi. How did you know about that attaché case, Inspector?
Oh, the wine shop mentioned that you had it with you when you paid your bill. So my sergeant checked back in with your garage and your tailor. They both remembered you having it with you when you paid them.
Yes, I use it instead of a briefcase.
Well, these taxi men are pretty good at turning things in. I hope you'll find it all right. Oh, Mr. Halliday.
Before you go, Inspector, I think Mr. Wendis has something to tell you.
What's going on with you?
Where did you put it, Tommy?
What?
When I was in here just now, there was a small attaché case. I can't remember just where I saw it, but...
Got the key, Tommy? Just a minute. Why did you say you left this in a taxi?
I thought I had. Oh, don't be a fool, Max. I've got the key here somewhere. I don't know what all the fuss is about.
If there's no key, we're gonna have to open it some other way.
Max, I...
Why, there must be over £500 here. Where did you get it?
I can tell you why he got it. That money was to have been paid to a man named Swan, after he had murdered Mrs. Wendis in this room. As you know, there was an accident, so it wasn't necessary to pay Swan after all. Obviously, he could produce all this without questions being asked, so he's lived on it. He's been living on it ever since the 28th of September.
Well, Mr. Wendis?
Just now you said you'd do anything to save Margo. Now what's changed your mind?
Before you came, Inspector, Mr. Halliday was trying to convince me to go to the police with the most fantastic story you've ever heard. Apparently, I hired Swan to murder Mrs. Wendis. That's not all. I stole a handbag, and correct me if I'm wrong, Max, I sent you those two blackmail notes. What else, Max?
And you planted it on the body, in that stocking that was found.
Oh yes, the stocking. Perhaps I'd better tell it. It may sound more like a confession. You know that stocking of Mrs. Wendis's that you found? Well, apparently, substituted it, is that the right word, Max? For the other one. You understand, you know what I mean. What else, Max?
He told Swan he would hide his key somewhere out here. Probably on this ledge. Swan let himself in, then hid behind the curtain. And then Wendis phoned from the hotel and brought her
around. Just a minute. If Swan had used Mr. Wendis's key, the key would have still been on him when he died. But no key was found when we went through his pockets.
Well, come on, Max. Your move.
Swan could have taken the key from here, unlocked the door, and then returned it to the ledge before he went in.
All right, Mr. Halliday. This is all very interesting, but it isn't getting me any nearer what I came to find out.
But this is a matter of life and death. What else matters?
What matters to me is where Mr. Wendis got this money. That's all I want to know.
We'll soon find out how long he's had it.
Now what's the matter?
There you are, Inspector. The last check he wrote was on the 27th of September. That was the day before all this happened. I tell you, he's been living on it ever since. Here's his bank statement.
Well, he hasn't drawn any large sums from his bank. Nothing over £53.
But just look at these, Inspector. Nearly every week, £35, 40, 45, 35. He could have saved it up.
Oh, of course. I could have been planning all this for years.
Where did you get it?
Are you sure you want to know? I promise you, Max, you won't like the answer.
Come on.
All right. You asked for it. When I got home from the party that night, I found Margot bent over the body, searching for something. She kept muttering something about that he had something of hers, but she couldn't find it. She was nearly hysterical. That's why I wouldn't let the police question her that night. In the state she was in, she would have told every lie under the sun. The next morning, she produced that money, just as it is now. And she said if anything should happen to her, that I should make sure the police didn't find it. So after she was arrested, I took it, and I put it in a check room in Charing Cross Station. Whenever I needed money, I would take it out and then check it into some other check room. You see, she was just about to give it to Swan when she decided to kill him instead.
Do you expect anyone to believe this?
Well, I've really no idea. How about it, Inspector?
Well, it certainly seems to fit in with the verdict at the trial.
You're not even going to check up on this? She's being hanged tomorrow.
All of this has been out of my hands for months. There's been a trial and an appeal.
Of course it wouldn't do you much good, would it? You would have to admit that you arrested the wrong person.
I think you ought to go.
You better go. But you made one mistake. What will happen when Margot hears about this?
Since she'll deny it, of course.
And perhaps she'll change her will. You will have done all this for nothing.
Suppose I had come to the police with that wild story of his, Inspector. Would anyone have believed me?
Not a chance, sir. Before nearly every execution, someone comes forward like this. This must have been very distressing for you, coming as it did.
Do you think they'll let him see her? I don't want her upset just now.
Have a word with your barrister. He might be able to prevent it. Oh. And I should get that money into the bank before someone pinches it.
Yes, thank you. I think I will.
What sort of things?
Just some books and a handbag, I believe. They would like you to come along and collect them sometime.
You mean after tomorrow?
Yes. Or today, if you like. Just ask the desk sergeant. He knows all about it.
Well, goodbye, Mr. Winnis. I
don't suppose we shall meet again.
Goodbye, Inspector, and thank you.
Chief Inspector here. Get me Sergeant O'Brien, quick.
O'Brien.
Hubbard. Look, O'Brien, I've got back in again. Start the ball rolling.
Yes, sir.
here? What's the idea?
Where's his bank statement?
Never mind about that. You've got to get out of here, quick.
Have you got it?
Shh, not so loud.
Don't you see?
Shut up! If you want to save Mrs. Wendis, keep quiet and let me handle this.
You?
Shh. You nearly ditched us then. I should have locked you up.
What is all this?
They talk about flat-footed policemen. May the saints protect us from the gifted amateur. You'd better prepare yourself for a surprise, Mr. Halliday.
Where's Tony?
He's gone out.
When will he be back?
We're not sure. All right, Thompson. Was it you who rang just now?
Yes. Why didn't you let me in?
You've got a key. Why didn't you use it?
I did, but it didn't work.
And you know why, don't you?
No. Has the lock been changed?
May I have your bag? You knew this wasn't your key, didn't you?
No.
Your husband has explained this, you know. You can tell us all about it now.
What is it? I don't understand.
No, I don't believe you do. Why don't you sit down, Mrs. Wendis? What's going on here? Thompson! Sir, take this bag to the police station, will you?
Yes, sir.
Wait a minute, you clot. You can't go down the street looking like that. Here, put it in this.
Margo.
Yes, sir.
What is this? Why are you here?
I don't know. About an hour ago, the warden came to see me and said that I could leave. And two detectives came and brought me here. And they popped around the corner. But then I couldn't get this door open. When I went back out, the policeman was still there, and he just said that I could go. So he walked me around to the garden. Where's Tony? They said that he was supposed to visit me this morning, but he couldn't make it. Has something happened to him?
No, nothing. Inspector, do you think you could tell us what you're up to?
Mrs. Wendis, what I have to tell you may come as a shock.
Yes.
Well, we strongly believe that your husband had planned to murder you.
He's right, Margo. He arranged for Swan to come here that night and kill you.
How long have you known this?
Did you suspect it yourself?
No. Never. And yet I... What's the matter with me, Max? I don't seem to be able to feel anything. Shouldn't I have a breakdown or something?
It's a delayed reaction, that's all. In a couple of days, you're going to have one hell of a breakdown. When did you find out?
Oh, first clue came quite by accident.
We discovered that your husband had been spending large numbers of £1 notes all over the place. It ran into just over £300, and it appeared to have started just about the time you were arrested. Now, I had to find out where he got this money and how. So, yesterday afternoon, I went to the prison, and I asked to see your handbag, and while I was doing this, I managed to lift your latchkey. Highly irregular, of course, but my blood was up. And then this morning, when your husband was out, I came here to look at his bank statement. I never saw it, because I never got through that door. You see, the key I had taken from your handbag didn't fit the lock. Shh, don't make a sound.
Which way did he go?
Hold on. Towards the police station, sir.
Right.
That was a near one.
I don't understand. Why have you brought me here?
And the handbag, and make sure he sees the key. Better make him check the contents and sign for it. And if he asks for his own key and raincoat, tell him I've gone to class.
Yes, sir.
Any questions?
No questions.
Right. Call me back when he leaves the station.
Well, Mr. Halliday, have you got it?
I don't think so.
Oh, where is Mrs. Windis's key?
It took me just half an hour to find it.
But if it was there, why didn't Windis use it just now?
He didn't use it because he doesn't realize it's there. He still thinks it's in his wife's handbag. You see, you were very nearly right. He told Swan to put your key under the stair carpet, Mrs. Windis, and then return the key before he came in.
And it's been out.
But as Swan was killed, he naturally assumed that your key would still be under the stair carpet. That was his little, would be, he assumed that your key would still be in one of Swan's pockets. That was his little mistake. Because he did exactly what you suggested, Mr. Halliday. He unlocked the door and then returned the key before he came in.
And it's been out there ever since. And the key Windis took out of Swan's pocket and returned to her handbag was
Swan's own latchkey. Given even I didn't guess that at once. At first I thought perhaps your husband had changed the lock. It always surprised me that no key was found on Swan's body. After all, most men carry a latchkey about with them. Then I had a brain. I took the key that was in your handbag to Mrs. Van Dorn's and unlocked the door of her apartment. Then I borrowed a telephone and called Scotland Yard.
I don't understand. Why have you brought me here?
Because you were the only other person who could have possibly known that that key was outside. I had to find out if you knew it was there.
Suppose I had known.
You didn't.
Oh. Max?
Yes, sir.
I think I'm going to have a breakdown now.
Oh. Chief Inspector here?
Yes, sir. He's just left the station.
Try and hang on a little longer. Brilliant! Brilliant! Williams? He's just left the station. Give me a thump if he comes this way.
Yes, sir.
What happens now?
Sooner or later, he'll come back here. As I've pinched his key, he'll have to use the one in your handbag. And when that doesn't fit, he'll realize his mistake. Put two and two together and look under the stair carpet.
But if he doesn't do that, all of this is pure guesswork. That's, we can't prove a thing.
That's perfectly true. But once he opens that door, we shall know everything.
What will you do then?
I'm to phone Scotland Yard. They're standing by for my call now.
And Mrs. Windus?
We'll have nothing else to fear.
Oh. All right, Margot?
Yes, I'm all right.
Oh. Quiet now, you two. He's going around by the garden. He'll see the broken glass.
He's remembered.
Again, don't let the tears.